Thank you, Pastor Jeff and Shannon, Jillian. Praise the Lord. Amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 12. We are in our saga of Acts chapter 12. Let me give you a title for tonight. It's this. I'll put it up on the screen. Unexpected expectations. Unrecognized answers to prayer. So the church is taking off. We're continuing in our saga. And the church is just expanding. It's bulging. It's going everywhere it possibly can go. We're in the beginning of a great movement of God. It's called the Great Commission. And Jesus told us that. He told us about the Great Commission. He said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. That is the Great Commission. It's never stopped. And so that Great Commission is just starting in our chapters of since chapter 10. The great 19th century evangelist, by the way, Hudson Taylor, is evangelist to China, said this in a quote. He said, the Great Commission is not an option to be considered. It is a command to be observed. So that is our command, to go and to make disciples of all the world. And the book of Acts is the initial push into that. So we see Jesus walking on earth. We know that that's in Acts chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. All that Jesus began to do and teach until the day which he was taken up. That's Jesus returning to heaven or ascending to heaven. And then Acts, the rest of it, is the church age. Jesus working through his church, through believers. All that Jesus continued to do and teach after he was taken up. So we are right now in chapter 12. I believe we are studying from Thursday to Thursday as a journey. And I believe it's a great adventure. I believe what's happening is we're doing a journey through the book of Acts. And that's what we're doing. We're journeying through it. And as we journey through the book of Acts, we're journeying through ourselves. Somebody say amen. Because we're watching some truths come back up to us. And it all started with an amazing spiritual transformation of a group of uneducated, frightened believers with one Jesus of Nazareth. We know that there's an amazing truth here. When you ask yourself a question, the founding of the church in Acts chapter 1, verse 1 to chapter 8, verse 3, is a preliminary question only in Acts. How did Jesus' disciples, mostly uneducated Galileans, influence the entire Roman world? And you're going to see that. They're going to overtake almost 3,000 years of paganism in just a couple of decades. So you got to ask yourself a question. How in the world did they do that? What changed these men who fled in fear and arrest the death of Jesus into fearless advocates for worshiping Jesus as Lord and God? Can I tell you what changed them? The same thing you felt when Pastor Jeff and his family sang. It was the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit changed them. That's what changes anyone. Not religion, but it's the Holy Spirit. Come on, somebody say amen. It's power. The Holy Spirit was moving. So we will remember from last week, Peter's report to the Jerusalem church. Remember? He went back to these men who were totally Jewish and had to tell them about eating with a Gentile and going into his house, doing something that was ritually unclean. And I told you last week, and I want to correct something too. I told you about the 8 Noahide laws or Noahistic laws. I kept saying 8. And somebody reminded me that I only had 7 up there. There are only 7 Noahistic laws. I got a little carried away. I want to give you one of my own. But these are the 7 universal laws. These are what Jews today believe that Gentiles can do to get to heaven. The Jews follow 623 laws. They have to follow those laws, Orthodox Jews, to get to heaven. But they believe if you're a Gentile, you only have to follow 7. And I've given the Hebrew words for them. Avodah Zarah, which is prohibition on idolatry, no other god. Berkat Hashem, prohibition on blasphemy and cursing the name of God. Shefishant Damin, prohibition on murder. Gesel, prohibition on robbery and theft. Gilui Ayuat, prohibition on immorality and forbidden sexual relations. Evermin Hashe, prohibition on removing and eating a limb from a live animal. And Dinim, requirement to establish a justice system and courts of law to enforce the other 6 laws. So Jews, even today, believe that Gentiles are only under the Noahide laws. You can get to heaven by just doing these 7 laws, not 8. And so you can get to heaven by doing those. They have 623. So when Peter comes back and tells them that he's been in a Gentile house and that salvation, by the way, salvation was a Jewish concept back then. It wasn't Christian. They weren't even called Christians yet. It was a Jewish concept. It was a sect of Judaism. They had believed that Jesus was their Jewish Messiah. And so they said, you can't do that. They were giving him trouble until he told them what happened. So his report to the Jerusalem church makes them believers that God has indeed visited the Gentiles. Then what they do is Barnabas was sent out by them to a revival that was in Antioch. Because the Christians, Jewish Christians, had fled to Antioch, 300 miles away from Jerusalem, because of the persecution of Stephen. Barnabas is going to Tarsus then, to find Saul. Saul has had an experience on the Damascus Road 10 years earlier. So Saul's in Tarsus, the home of his birth, and he's meditating for 10 years. So Barnabas, sent out by the Christian, by the Jerusalem church to Antioch, where a revival is going on, how many are following me, says, wow, this is a huge revival. I'm going to go find Saul. He can associate with these people because Saul is an intellect, he's a Roman citizen, and he can do something. So Saul comes with him, and they basically end up preaching in Antioch for one solid year. So when they had found him, Barnabas finding Saul, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for a whole year, they assembled at the church and taught a great many people, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. So they're called Christians, and by the way, it is not a good term. It's not given to them by themselves. It's given to them by Jews and people who want to make fun of them. They call them Christ followers. How many of you know that that is not a funny term to us? That is a great term. And so basically, before we pick it up, let me lay some church history on you, because I'm amazed at this. I'm amazed that just a couple people are going to change all of history. How many believe that can still happen? Just a couple people. And so let me show you how they changed history. This is the church the phases it's gone through since then, since apostolic ages till today. We have the early church times, AD 1 to 590 AD. We have the apostolic age, which we're talking about right now, 30 AD to 100 AD. The time of the martyrs, 60 to 313, when Rome is going to start persecuting and killing people, killing Christians, just for no other reason because they're Christian, because they're taking over their society. And then the Christian rulers, 313 to 590 AD. The medieval times, 590 to 517. The missionary era, the papal era, the pre-Reformation era, 1294 or 1517. By the way, up to 1517, the whole church is a Catholic church. Now, let me remind you what the word Catholic means. The word Catholic means universal. Believe it or not, you are Catholic today. I know you're a Protestant, but you're part of the universal church. It means universal. Roman Catholic is something totally different. And so, the modern times, the 1517, Martin Luther to the present. We have the Reformation era, 1517 to 1648. The denominations era. Somebody asked me the other day, where do we get all these denominations? How did they come up? Look at those dates. 1648 to 1790. Everybody's had to have their own denomination. They went wild. There's thousands of denominations, Christian denominations. And from 1790 to now, it's missions and liberalism. It's running hand in hand. We see the church being very powerful, a Philadelphia church, and we see it being very weak, a Laodicean church. They're walking side by side right now towards the advent of Christ returning. So we see these eras. Now, we are in the first part of it, the apostolic age from 30 to 100 AD. We know that what's going on here, we are in Acts chapter 12, about 43 to 45 AD, based on the worldwide famine of Emperor Claudius as prophesied by Agabus. And so he said this last week, just a little review. So Agabus gets there and he says, now at this time some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and began to indicate by the Spirit that there would certainly be a great famine all over the world. And this took place in the reign of Claudius, Emperor Claudius. Here's the emperor himself, Claudius Caesar. And by the way, we know, historians tell us, that in fact, that there was a worldwide famine during his reign. So we can actually date when this happens. So, a little further along the church history story. By 70 AD, just 25 years after what we're talking about tonight, just 25 and 35 years after the first Gentiles that's converted, Cornelius, Christianity has spread this far. It's spread all over the Roman world. As a matter of fact, look how many churches have been established by Paul and Barnabas, will be established by Paul and Barnabas, and some of the ones that they converted in the ministry by 100 AD. This will show you some of the churches. All those little red dots are churches by 100 AD, second century, that have been established by Paul or Barnabas or some of the followers of theirs. There are hundreds of churches that are being established in just 50 short years. They're expanding all over the known world. If you want to go a little bit further, and I do want to go a little bit further, by 600 AD, the vast Roman Empire, the entire civilized world, have been evangelized, the entire civilized world. This is all Christianity. The heavy spots, the spread of Christianity in Europe about 325 AD, and the rest of that blue is the spread of Christianity in Europe of AD 600. If you look up all the way over there, the Arsacid dynasty is the dynasty of Armenia to Christianity in 301 AD. It's not recognized on that map as a color. But Christianity has spread all over the known world by 600 AD. And look, by 100, just go back to 100 AD. By 100 AD, these are the large churches that have at least estimated over 1,000 people in them. All those little those names you see, Caesarea, Jerusalem, Tyre, Apernes, Salamis, Laodicea, Tarsus, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, the seven cities of Asia Minor, Rome, Nicopolis, Puteoli, Syracuse, all of them had at least 1,000 people in them. So we're talking about people flooding to Christianity in the first 100 years. And it all started with conversion of Cornelius, first Gentile, the conversion of Saul, who is a Hellenistic Jew, the Peter's testimony of salvation to the Gentiles, Barnabas being sent out by the church, and Barnabas finding Saul and bringing him back to Antioch. And that's as far as we've gone in our study so far. In short, we are still in the beginnings of this powerful movement we know as the church, Christianity, if you will. So tonight we pick it up in Acts chapter 12. Wow, that was a lot of review, wasn't it? I call this account Unexpected Expectations or Unrecognized Answers to Prayer. Mark Twain was noted for his clever phrases and quotes. Some of them are called truisms, and in fact, some of them are pretty witty. Listen to this one he says. If you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed. If you do read the newspaper, you are misinformed. He also said this. Worrying is like paying a debt you don't owe. And then he said this. Kindness is the language which the deaf can hear and the blind can see. But I don't agree with everything he said, because he also said this, and I don't agree with it. He said, the secret source of humor is not joy, but sorrow. There is no humor in heaven. I do not agree with that. No. Listen, the Lord shares our sorrows, and he never laughs at us. Somebody say amen. But surely he laughs with us when we discover that our sense of unanswered prayer in a situation was only that we had not recognized the answer that he had already given. I'm sure there's times when we go through a situation and we think our prayers are unanswered, only to find out later that, oh, God really did answer that, and we get a little chuckle out of it. Once we realize the answers were there all along, we laugh at our nervous lack of expectation. I think the Lord enjoys the laugh with us. I think he delights in surprising us with answers to our prayers that are beyond what we could have asked for or imagined or even hoped for. Matter of fact, Ephesians tells us that. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, it says, now to him who is able to do immeasurably above all we may ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever, amen. So we're going to talk about prayer a little bit tonight in a different way. And I'm going to give you a prayer challenge also. Well, I want you to understand that God answers our prayers. He always answers our prayers. Sometimes he answers our prayers unexpectedly in a way that you never thought was going to happen. Come on, somebody say amen. And you just have to sit back sometimes and just chuckle and say, man, I now see what he's doing. How many are with me a little bit? In Acts chapter 12, Dr. Luke interprets his intense account and interrupts it. He interrupts that intense account of the birth and the rapid expansion of the church to give us some comic relief. You heard me right. Comic relief, humor, comedy. He enjoys telling these accounts of how the Lord gave answers to the very prayers as people are still praying, not knowing the answers were already happening. The first account of Peter being released from prison while Christians were still praying for him, and their inability to recognize the answer when it came and literally knocked on their door, is told very humorously, by the way, by Luke in Acts chapter 12. You may not read it that way, but it is humorous, and I'll show you how. We laugh through it with Luke, then suddenly realize that he's actually helped us laugh at ourselves when we receive unexpected expectations to our prayers. How many have received an answer to prayer that was made you just kind of chuckle because it was just better than you ever could think? That's what he's talking about. See, humor is a great dynamic in communication, even Christian communication. Let me give you an example. Some of you are faster than others, I've noticed. Here's another one for you. And I especially like this one. It frees us to laugh at ourselves many times, comedy does, and with others. It connects us. Comedy always connects us. Let me tell you a little about humor. If you want to tell somebody something funny, it's best not to introduce it by saying this. Now, I'm going to tell you a very funny joke. That puts the hearers on the defensive and decide just how funny it really is. The comic that was introduced as the funniest man in the world will never get a laugh out of a crowd that's determined not to respond because of his exaggerated introduction. Luke doesn't tell us he's going to be humorous. He just does it, as you'll see next week, by the way. Remember, Luke is writing to this to one person. He is writing to this person, Theophilus. The former treatise have I made, Acts 1:1. O Theophilus, all that Jesus began both to do and teach. We believe Theophilus was a leader of one of the early Christian leader of the Antioch church, who actually supported some of the Paul's missionary journeys. So he's telling a story. Luke is communicating the power of our life in Christ in our own humanness through humor, so we can relate to it and associate with its deeper meaning. So let me show you a little bit about what's going on here. Acts chapter 12, verse 1 to 3 doesn't sound like it's starting out too humorous. It was about that time that King Herod arrested some of the belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. This is in Jerusalem. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. He beheaded him. When he saw that this met with approval among the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. So we know that Christianity is spreading all over the known world. We know it's spreading in Jerusalem. We know that Herod is going to be the one, and I'll tell you who this Herod is. He's going to try to keep the peace. King Herod discovered how to gain favor from the Jews by persecuting Christians. It was a tough time for the church in Jerusalem. This was Herod Agrippa I, who was the nephew of Herod Antipas, who had murdered John the Baptist and the grandson of Herod the Great. Now, I know that means nothing to you right now, so let me show you who it was so you understand. The Herod line. Herod the Great, he's the Herod that killed babies. That's up on top. He's the one that died in 4 BC. We know Jesus had to be born before 4 BC because Herod was the one that killed babies. We also know he had some sons, Herod Antipas, Archelaus, Philip, and Aristobulus. These were the ones he divided his kingdom up to. Of course, he didn't like Aristobulus, so he killed him in 7 BC, his own son. Oh, he also didn't like Alexander. He was a son too. He killed him in 7 BC also. And Antipater, he didn't like even before that. He killed him, or later, he killed him in 4 BC. So he killed three of his sons. That's just three of his household. He killed many of them. So his kingdom was divided by these. Herod Antipas is the Herod of Jesus' day. He murders John the Baptist. But the Herod we're talking about is Herod Agrippa I. He's the Herod of Paul's day. He kills James, and he's imprisoned Peter. That's the Herod that we're talking about. Herod Agrippa I. And this man is a terror. He is someone that you do not want to tangle with. This is a portrait of him, and it's a life-like portrait of him from one of the statues, one of the many that he had erected in his own. Talk about a dysfunctional family. He was trained in Rome under the wicked influence of Caligula, the selfish and egotistical son of the Roman emperor, who will later become one of the grossest Roman emperors that we have ever seen. Later, this Herod was appointed to rule in Palestine and given power in stages until he ruled over the largest realm of anyone since his grandfather, Herod the Great. The secret of his success was that he learned how to please the Jews. He was a placator. The Jews had consistently persecuted the church, and the loss of Saul of Tarsus as chief Gestapo officer must have enraged them. Herod arrested James, and he had him beheaded. Now, understand, James is the ruler, the leader of the Christian church in Jerusalem. You may want to ask some questions. Why would God allow James to be beheaded? How many are with me? What happened to those massive prayers of the church? That brought him such acclaim from the leaders of Israel, they went after another principal leader of the Christians, Simon Peter. He arrests him and he puts him in prison. And Herod, knowing of his escape once before, because Peter escaped once before, took no chances. Luke prepares us for the wonder and the humor of what happened later by telling us the extent of the king's precaution to keep Peter in prison before he followed through on his obvious intention to behead him. So he's going to behead Peter. There's no question about that. So here's what he does. After arresting him, Peter, he puts him in prison, handling him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. 16 soldiers. It's called a squad. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. He's going to behead him right after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. Now I want you to really analyze this with me tonight. Here's the situation, and don't miss it. We see that this is happening. Herod's persecuting the church. James, the brother of John, has already been martyred. Peter's arrested and scheduled for killing after the Passover. So the church begins praying earnestly for Peter. And I don't want you to miss what's going to happen, and I'll outline it for you. Here's what this says. What was Peter bound in shackles with while in prison? Well, and when Herod was about to bring him out, verse 6, that night Peter was in chains between two soldiers and guards before the door were keeping the prison. So he is taking no chances. Peter had escaped once before through an angel, and now he's taking no chances. He has 16 soldiers that are watching him. Since when, though, do chains of any type hold back the power of God? The deeper truth here is that there is no bondage, there is no chain, there's no demonic guards that have more power to hold us than Jesus has power to release us. We need to know that there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name to break every single chain. He's broken them since Peter's day. He's continued to break them. He's broken them over my life. He's broken them over many of your lives. I want you to understand, let me remind you that while Peter is in prison, the whole church at Jerusalem is praying in Jesus' name. There's no telling how many times they spoke out the name of Jesus with Peter in mind. And there's another powerful message here in this verse for us. And it says this. It says, take comfort that God is in control. Verse 6, the night before Peter was to be placed on trial, before he's going to be beheaded, what would you do the night before you're going to be beheaded? You know what he does? He gets a good night's sleep. He's asleep. Chained between two soldiers. Could you imagine? He's asleep. He is relaxing in God. He understands that his life is in God's hands. How many of you understand that? Your life is in God's hands. It's not in my hands. It's not in your employer's hands. It's not in some denomination's hands. It's not in anybody else's hands except God's hands. What God decides, he decides. When I was lying in a hospital bed in MD Anderson, and they were looking at me and thinking that I was going to die the next day, I was reminded that my life was not in the doctor's hands. My life is in God's hands. The Bible says that God makes alive and God kills. It says that he rejoices in the death of the saints, and I was ready to go. My doctor said to me not too long ago, how could you have such faith like that? I said, it's easy. What choice do you have other than trust God? Who are you going to trust? Are you going to trust a team of doctors? Who are you going to trust? So he's relaxing. He understands. Let me remind you that while he's in prison, the whole church is praying for him. Hudson Taylor, again, a persecuted missionary to China, said this, and I love his quotes. He said this, "The Lord is my shepherd, not was, not maybe, nor will be. Is my shepherd on Sunday, on Monday, is through every day of the week. In January, it is in December, every month of the year. Is at home and is in China. Is in peace and is in war. In abundance and in penury. Jesus is the Lord. The Lord is your shepherd. He is your shepherd all the time. He doesn't take any time off. He doesn't take any vacations. He's always there for you, always watching over you. Now, you may be discouraged. You may be disgusted. You may be in a spot that you're in a low spot. Maybe you're listening tonight and you're low someplace in one of those 160 countries. But if you trust in the Lord your God and you believe in the name of Jesus Christ, the Bible tells me he is your shepherd. He will always be your shepherd, and he won't take any time off, and he won't get discouraged with you. He won't get tired of you, and he won't leave you alone. He won't abandon you. He'll always be there for you. Come on, somebody say amen. Amen. Maybe you're tonight and you're letting your anxious and you're listening and you're anxious or you're worried or you have a problem. Don't miss the impact of verse 6. It was Passover, and the time was not most propitious for his purposes. He appointed four squads to guard one man. A squad, by the way, is 16 men. This is a Roman squad. They were used in a V. There was a wedge to use to break the enemy line and force them into close quarters combat. It was very successful. It was 16 men. They'd make a V, and they would go into the enemy lines. These men were the foot soldiers. They were trained military men. These are the ones that saw the most battle. And these are the ones he puts over Peter. He must have thought he was pretty dangerous. He puts these 16 trained men over Peter. Now, I want you to see the whole pathos of it, of the story. So it was 16 guards for one spiritual leader who had broken no law and proclaimed peace and love. Really a threat. A bit of background study heightens how these guards would have functioned. They probably served on three-hour watches, with two guards chained to the prisoner and two at the door. If the four guards meant a rotation of four men every 3 hours, that was the precaution enough. But it may have meant that there were 16 men there at a time. All this to point up the human impossibility of escaping. There was nothing the church could do except pray. Except pray? Many previously answered prayers should have told the Christians that there is no more powerful thing you can do, no more powerful weapon than prayer. Prayer is our weapon of mass destruction. The Christians knew what Herod intended to do. How could they face the future without their beloved Peter? But note that they did not pray for a miraculous release. This is where that humor is going to come in a little bit later. They're not praying for a miraculous release. Let me read to you again, verse 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing in the church unto God for him. Not for him to be released. Now, Luke is very, very detailed in his accounts. Other places, he'll tell the exact prayers what they prayed. They're not praying for Peter to be released. They're just praying for him. And you need to understand the reason why this is going on. It shows us the diminished expectation of the church was experiencing. There was no bold prayers at this time in the name of Jesus for Peter's release. They asked that he be sustained and strengthened. The original language there says that Peter would be sustained and at peace right before he would die. But in the light of Luke's careful account of specific prayers and astounding answers all through Acts, we're fairly confident that he would have used this as a further evidence of how intercessory prayer was answered. But as the story is related by Luke, it not only sets up the subsequent humor, but it involves us in empathy for the church. One of the great problems we all face is not how to pray, now listen, but what to pray. When a person we love is in trouble, we wonder what's best. We are reluctant to be specific in our intercession because we fear telling God what we think is best. We get into muddy water when our will versus God's will, as if the two could not be the same. Years of trying to learn how and what to pray for others has taught me to spend more time listening to what the Lord wants me to ask rather than actually asking. Let me repeat that. We go to the Lord in prayer and we instantly ask what we want. I'm not so sure we should do that. I think we should pray first, God, what do you want me to ask you? I want to line up with your will. Then the asking can be what he is more ready to give us. I'd rather hear, ask me for this than just ask for what you think. Here I want to go slow because I'm going to explain what I call flawed prayer logic. Look, let me put it this way. Sometimes we get discouraged at what we believe to be unanswered prayers. We assume that there was no answer because what happened was not what we wanted. Come on, somebody say amen. Our limited view of time, eternity, and God's will narrows our perception of what the answer should be. Even after years of seeing God use what we thought were problems for a greater potential, I've seen it in my own cancer. What the enemy intended for evil, God used for my good. But even after we see that, even after we know verses like this that Joseph said, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for my good. Even after we've seen that, even after we know that we've gotten in serious trouble, wondering how we're going to get out, and God used it for our good, consequently, like my cancer, or like Joseph being thrown in prison and becoming elevated to the second in command. Even though we've seen that in the past, we many times forget those past experiences when we pray, and we get caught up in judging what God will do in a present situation on the basis of what we thought he should have done previously, and he didn't. Let me explain it from our study. This is perhaps what the church was in Jerusalem was facing. They probably were thinking or saying, we prayed for James, and he was beheaded. What else can we expect for Peter? Let me give you an example from years ago. Years ago, and I wrote it down, a woman came to see me about her inability to pray for her sick husband. I remember it very well. They had been married for a few brief years. She had lost a previous husband through cancer. She prayed for him and he died. She felt panicked not only for the danger of further loss, but by failure of her prayers for her first husband. What she could not trust was God's sovereignty, that he is all-powerful to deal with each situation according to a greater plan than we can fathom. The significant difference between the two men was that her first husband was a Christian. Her ailing second husband was not. Then I asked her what she would have prayed if she did not limit God but what she accused them of not doing when she asked before. Her reply was very revealing to me. She said, I thought about it a lot. I'd asked the Lord to bring him to a relationship with him, and I'd asked that nothing happened to him until he was sure of that. I told her that all that thinking about what to pray had been prayer in itself. The Lord was getting her ready to ask. Her prayer was answered. He became a Christian, and today, right now, he's still alive. And so you can't limit God by your prayers. We must always pray with expectation, regardless if we feel our past prayers were answered or not answered our way. Come on, somebody say amen. And we must know how to pray. I'm going to give you this as an aside. I'm not going to give it to you, and I'm going to stop on it tonight because I want to go further. I'm going to give you a prayer challenge. This is all the places in Scripture where prayer is mentioned. 31-day Scripture writing challenge. If you take a picture of that and you read those, then you need to write down what prayer is about. That's going to tell you exactly everything about prayer as you need it. So if you have your cameras, you want to take that picture, you can go ahead and do that. I'm not going to teach on it. That's everything you should know about prayer. But before I turn to the next slide, I'll give you time to do that. Before I turn to the next slide, let me tell you this. When we build our prayers on negative expectations, the results are disastrous. Let me repeat that. When you pray this way, well, I don't know if God's going to do it, or you know, you're never going to get your prayers answered that way. Somebody say amen. When we do that, we expect too little from God, and that's what we ask for. Too little. Then we're disappointed that the Lord didn't do better for us when we pray. When we pray, we must pray. I'm still seeing cameras. When we pray, get ready. I'm going to be taking that down for a second. When we pray, here's how we have to pray. I'll wait. When we pray, we must pray like this. We must pray big. Yeah. You cannot pray small. So many people pray small. It's like, oh, I'll pray this prayer, but I don't know. You got to pray big. You got to believe. Come on, somebody say amen. Do you know what the Secret Service are told to do when they're guarding a president and shots are fired his way? You know what they're told? They're told to stand in front of him and make themselves big. Get big. Be a target. Get big. When we confront the enemy, we've got to get big in our prayers. We have got to get big. Listen, when you affirm big, when you believe big, and when you pray big, putting faith into action, big things happen. You cannot pray small. You have to pray big because we know that greater is the one who lives in you. Pray big today. If you're praying about something, don't start wavering in your prayers. Don't start thinking, well, it hasn't been answered yet. You start praying bigger. If it doesn't get answered, pray bigger. Just keep praying big, saying, God, I'm believing for big things. Ephesians 3:20 tells us, I'm going to get excited here, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. He's able to give you something bigger than you can have your biggest prayer on. He wants to give you something more than you're praying for right now. Come on, this is what faith is all about. If you're a Christian today, you need to dream big. You need to pray big. You need to believe big. Simply stated, I want you to understand what it's talking about. Believe big. Dream big. Pray big. Come on. Oh, so-and-so, I know what happens. Have you noticed that the bigger the problems happen, the bigger we ask for prayers? Oh, you've heard it so many times. Oh, so-and-so has stage 4 cancer. We really need to pray for them. What are they saying? They're saying, come on, let's pray big. But all of our prayers should be big prayers, no matter what the problem is. Let me repeat it. Expectation is a crucial part of dynamic prayer, but it must be built on the insight and the guidance of prolonged prayer to know how to pray. Building our prayers on unguided, negative expectations is disastrous. We expect far too little and we ask for it. Then we're disappointed that the Lord didn't do better for us. The formula for creative intercessory prayer is this: listen carefully, ask boldly, trust completely, and know that the answer is part of the tapestry of God's greater plan. He always has a greater plan. He uses everything for His glory and our growth if we only allow Him. Don't start thinking negative because a prayer is not working out the way you think it should work out, because God's doing something far beyond our little tiny brains, and He has something in mind for us. A successful Christian life can be summed up in 4 short phrases, and I love this one. Here you go. Pray big and worry small. Trust God, love one another, laugh more and stress less, have faith and rejoice and be grateful. Man, you do that and you're going to sail. That is a key to Christianity. Look at it. Pray big, worry small, trust God, love one another, laugh more, stress less, have faith, rejoice and be grateful. You get those on the opposite way and you're going to get physically sick. If you start worrying and you start praying small, you're going to get sick. If you don't love one another and you don't trust God, you're going to have no faith at all and you're going to be depressed. If you are starting to let stress get to you, and you not have ability to laugh. Listen, Luke is telling us a humorous story in the middle of a very, very serious growth of the church. And you need to rejoice and be grateful. You need to have faith. How many things have God done for you? He gave you mercy today. He allowed you to get up and breathe. Mike, He allowed us to breathe today. He allowed us to give us another day on this planet. Come on, somebody say amen. He's given us life and He's given us breath. He's given us hope. Nobody can give you hope. Listen, you can live only 30 days without food, or 40. You can only live about 3 days without water. You can only live about 5 minutes without air. You can't live a minute without hope. You need hope, and hope only comes in Jesus Christ. Man, I don't know what's going on with me tonight, but I'm kind of excited. Next week, we will see the humorous answer to the church's prayer, but before we get there, it'll prove that God many times gives us what we haven't even asked for in His sovereignty, and He will show us how He gives us unexpected expectations. I'm going to be real honest with you tonight. And Cheryl's here and she will know this. With all the reports I got when I was lying in a hospital room in Houston, Texas, even though I had faith and I was okay, my faith was projecting me to say, it's all right, God, You can take me. I was okay. I was all right. My faith knew that I'd be in His hands and in His arms. I did not, Cheryl did, but I did not expect to live. I expect to see God. And I was okay with that. It wasn't a lack of faith. I think that's greater faith, to be honest with you. I was okay, but Cheryl was hanging on. She said, no, no, no. No, this is not your time. And I trusted her. I said, you're listening. I believe it. And so I started to pray. But I didn't expect what he did. I didn't expect. I mean, 40% of my bone marrow was dead. I remember going back home and saying to my oncologist here, saying, well, you know, I don't have any cancer anymore, but my bone marrow, 40% is dead. She said, oh, your bone marrow grows back. I remember walking out of that office. Remember, Cheryl? Saying, I'm going to get my bone marrow back. It's like, because that's where you produce red and white blood cells. So it's like, whoa, God's restoring this whole thing. You need to pray big tonight. Listen, and that's what I want to pray for all of us tonight before we leave. Big prayers. Unexpected expectations. And how when we pray big, we should expect the unexpected. Because as much as you want to plan your life, it has a way of surprising you with unexpected things that will make you happier than you originally planned. That's what you call God's will. He would have it that none should perish. He doesn't have bad things intended for you. He says He has good things intended for you, a divine plan for us. You still with me tonight? I like what C.S. Lewis said about it. Somebody says to me, well, I don't feel good enough. I don't think God's answering my prayers. I'm not good enough. You're never going to be good enough for God to answer your prayers. It's not about your goodness. It's about His. C.S. Lewis said this, the Christian does not think God will love us because we are good, but that God will make us good because He loves us. It's powerful. And so tonight, let me close by reminding all of us this. Expect the unexpected, because God might surprise you with something that if you always wanted, even if you didn't expect it to come around so soon. So tonight I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me. Man, listen, I'm not interested in giving a pep talk. I'm not interested in being a Tony Robbins of the Christian world. I'm not interested in giving you success through positive mental attitude. That's not my bag. I'm interested in giving you the full word of God. And the full word of God is, don't underestimate God. He's the creator of the universe. This is the one that can split the sky. If He came right down that right now, He could split this church in half. Let me tell you something. He's the God that can do anything. Nothing is impossible for Him. So tonight, I'm going to ask a question with our heads bowed. Have you been praying for something? Raise your hand. Now, be really honest. Have you been discouraged in your prayers? Raise your hand, because it hasn't come through. Man, tonight's the night to put down that discouragement. Tonight's the night that was fashioned just for you. Tonight's the night to say, I'm going to expect the unexpected. Come on, raise your hand. I'm going to expect the unexpected. Don't try to figure it out. Trust God. I'm going to ask us all to stand for a moment tonight. And I want to pray tonight for all of you. I want to pray a powerful, big prayer. Can I do that? Father, I thank You tonight, Lord. I pray right now, Lord God, for this group of believers. Lord, there's a reason why You brought them here tonight. There's a reason why they didn't have something else to do tonight. There's a reason why they showed up tonight. Lord, it was to hear Your word to encourage us, Lord God, to let us know that we need to expect the unexpected, Lord God, that we can pray boldly. Paul said, we can enter into the throne room boldly. We wear the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Lord, we can enter the Father's throne room. We can ask in Jesus' name. And Lord, I know right now that there will be unexpected answers to our prayers. Big things will happen from our big God. Lord, I know that we're not good enough, but I know that You are so good, Lord God. And I know, Lord Jesus, that even today, that You are answering prayers and You're answering them in big ways. Lord, help us not to delineate our prayers. Help us not to think small, Lord God. Help us to pray big, Lord Jesus. Help us to trust our big God with big answers to prayers. I thank You tonight, Lord God, for the answers, for they're already on their way. They're already coming, Lord God. We extend our faith and we receive them, Lord God. We receive them right now in Jesus' name. I pray a blessing on every family that is here, Lord God. Everyone that is here representative of their family, whether it's their immediate family or their extended family, bless them, Lord God. If they're unsaved in their family, bring them to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And Lord, for that one that will blaspheme and curse Your name, I pray big. Bring down the big fish, Lord God. Bring him down tonight, Lord God. Let him bow his knee for that drug addiction one person that's here, and a son, Lord God, that has drug addiction. I pray right now, Lord God, for a big prayer. Overdose him with Jesus Christ. I thank You tonight, Lord God. I pray a blessing on everyone that's here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Come on, somebody say amen tonight. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Pray big.